if we turn off. We didn't know what was going to happen when we did this, but we decided we'd do it anyway. Okay, now the real question that we had is, are we ever going to get these blimps back? So let's see if we can get the blimps back. And now I'd like to introduce the three students from MIT that came with me, Steve Strassman, Allison Druin in the back, and Mike Travers. They are part of this crazy project, and they will now retrieve their offspring. Now, when you think about it, these blimps can do lots of things. They can be fish, but they can also be microorganisms. And one of the ways we plan on starting the curriculum is perhaps just dipping into a fish pond and looking at what's going on underneath a microscope. And paramecia, you know, have a complex set of reactions. They react to noxious substances, and they're interested in food and in each other. And so these blimps are kind of three-dimensional, real graphics devices that can play a variety of roles. And we thought it'd be real fun to let the children, they're all radio-controlled, and so the children will be writing programs on machines like Macintoshes that will actually control the blimps and know when the blimps are running into things and so forth. Actually, we can leave one. You know, they say in the theater, never go on stage with a child or an animal. Because it's the ultimate of upstaging. People are always wondering what the child or the animal is going to do next. And I can see the blimps have exactly the same. Yay. Okay. We'll put them back in their little grotto there. Now, approach that we're going to use after working with physical models is to go to really super good high-resolution computer graphics. And I thought what I'd do is to show you, go back 20 years. I was in the original group at the University of Utah that invented 3D graphics, and here's what it looked like 20 years ago. It obviously does not look real. But all of this stuff is based on the idea that a television picture only has 30,000 dots. If you make every one of them the right color somehow, then you'll get an image that's absolutely indistinguishable from the real world. And people have worked at it. So those are from the first few years. Now, a little bit later, here are some flight simulators. Almost every major airline has one of these, and these are scenes simulated at the rate of 50 frames a second by the Evans and Sutherland flight simulators. So the realism here is much better. Now, when you have three-dimensional images like this, you'd always like to point to them. And here's an example of a pointing device that works in three space. She's grabbing on a little bead that's connected to wires. She can move this bead around in space, and so the computer knows where her hand is in space. But there's something even better. The computer can oppose the motion of her hand, and thus she can feel things. And this is built down at the University of San Diego to let chemistry students feel molecules and feel the surfaces of enzymes. So they can put their hand out in space and they can feel the contours. It's this thing, and this is a brick wall. You move your hand forward, it just stops. So the children will be interacting with things in the Vivarium project by using three-dimensional, touch-sensitive pointing devices. Now, this is 3D computer graphics of a couple of years ago. Japanese painting. And how about this one? This is Point Reyes, California. And the plants were grown and the mountains were grown also. Give you an idea of how things are set up. Now, we don't want computer graphics quite like this. Still a little bit too shiny. We want something more like this from Fantasia, or even better, something like this with airbrushing effects. And nobody has done this kind of computer graphics yet. It's one of the goals that we have, to get graphics of a level that an artist would not be ashamed of. Here's another example from Fantasia, what we expect to do. Now let me show you a series of clips. And this is the next to the last videotape, please. Just to give you an idea of how this stuff works a little bit and what the possibilities are. So here's what a model actually looks like. Things are represented by their outlines and manipulated. And now, here's the same exact scene rendered. So now you notice the marble, you notice the fish, textures, the gold, and you'll see some good metal type rendering. This is done by Bob Abel Studios. So now we're diving out of a book. You see, this stuff is like magic. Because, as I said, there are only 300,000 dots on the screen, and the computer can manipulate every one of them very quickly. Let's keep on just rolling the film continuously. Now you see some texture changes here, transparent, stone, American. Of course, we're interested in animals. And we're also interested in terrain. This is completely computer generated. These mountains are actually grown using geological models. Now, of course, we have to animate these things, and real animals have real mass. And underneath our skins is a mechanism. Now, notice how this is done by the Japanese. Notice how this tiger, this is almost exactly the movement of a tiger, and you can see how the tiger's skin is wrapped around it. So the children will be making models like that and then putting skin around them, from a kind of a Tinker Toy set. Now here's some character animation done by Chuck Suri. This has been the hardest for computer graphics people, because up to just a few years ago, they were more interested in what the images looked like than whether anything was happening. I think some people may remember that the people were worried they would care if Snow White was threatened by a huntsman, because after all, she was just a drawing. But of course, everybody was. Now here's the latest from Disney, showing an animation style done by Glenn Keane, who is working with us, that shows this softer, more intimate kind of rendering. And this is done by one of the best of the professional animators of today. It says don't blink in a minute, because it's a very quick shot. See, this is getting better. Thank you. Now, this is done by Digital Productions for the Hitachi Pavilion. This is a trip into the atmosphere of Jupiter. And what's better, they designed some animals that could live in this atmosphere. Gas balloons floating here. And some parasites that feed on these balloons. Notice the scene, this stuff could not be done any other way. Okay, now let's set up the movie. I brought one thing not on video, just so you could see how good it can actually get. This next scene is from my friends at Lucasfilms, and this was done by getting another Disney animator to come up and just simply do a story. They said, don't worry about anything, just make it, do it exactly the way you want it, and we will make the animation work out. So this is being, we're seeing this on 16 millimeter film. And they're simulating an entire forest here, leaf for leaf. Okay, now for our final example, please set up the last videotape. And let me tell you the story of this. This is a special effect also done by Lucasfilm. It's one of the, I think it's one of the most exciting things ever done in computer graphics, because it shows the creation of an entire world before your eyes. The plot in the film, which was Star Trek II, was that there's a gadget called the Genesis Bomb. And if you explode it on a dead moon, a fire will race across the surface of the planet and convert the planet into life-bearing mountains and oceans and rivers and so forth. And of course, the black side of the Genesis bomb is if you exploded it on a planet like Earth, it would do the very same thing. It would convert all of the living things on Earth to a new set of living things. So here is this sequence showing an entire world being created. Thank you. Okay, you can stop it now. Stop it, please. Thank you. Well, you know, the Greeks held that the visual arts were the imitation of life. The computer arts are the imitation of creation itself. Welcome to the Vivarium Project. Thank you very much. Thank you. I'd like to bring Bobby up, because if it weren't for her, it wouldn't have happened. I'd like to bring Anne Marion up, because if it weren't for her, it wouldn't have happened. And I'd like to bring Eric Stumacher and the Apple Hill Players, because if it weren't for them, tonight wouldn't have happened. And finally, Steve, Allison, and Mike, please.
And we want to thank Alan Kay and Apple, because we're going to have the next 5 years that are just fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And there, right now we have coffee and cookies and stuff, and we and the musicians will stick around to talk to people. Thank you.